Hi guys, and welcome to the JesusGirl.ent podcast. My name is Shaniqua Robinson, and today I will be your host. And so for Spotify for Podcaster, Google Podcasts, Apple Podcasts, Amazon Music, iHeartRadio, as well as every other streaming platform, thank you for allowing us to stream on your platform. To those of you who are tuning in, thank you so much for joining us. And to you who send donations, prayers, any form of support, thank you. We are so grateful for the love. Also, if you have been wondering how you can donate and sow into the ministry, all of that information is listed in the description section. And so, guys, we are here for a Soulful Soul Care Sunday. We are in the season of Do Not Allow the Offenses of Men to Allow You to Become an Offense to God. And so this is a very, very powerful topic, something that God was dealing with me in my own personal prayer time about, that I opened up to morning prayer about. And then also now I'm sharing with the JesusGirl.ent podcast. And so this is one thing I want to share with the people of God on that topic. This is a Soulful Soul Care Sunday. You guys know that on Soulful Soul Care Sunday, it's not like a Freedom Friday where we take a text. However, we're always going to reference, because the word of God is in my heart, and whatever's in the heart, in your heart, is going to come out of your mouth. And so that's why it's so important, even when we do or we are offended, that before you vent to anyone, before you pick up the phone and call anyone, before you open up a social media page, actually, you might have to shut a social media page down when your heart is hurt or full of offense, and vent to God. This is one thing that I've shared with the people of God that I'm connected to, is that before I speak to anyone, because they say, so is venting something that you should not do? And I don't believe it's a bad thing to vent occasionally, especially if you have like those you can confide in that can be trusted by God and also trusted by you with your most vulnerable moments. However, a good rule of thumb that I use is that before I go or I vent to anyone, I filter it through the Holy Spirit. And so what does that mean? I go out and prayer about everything that I'm experiencing. So once I have picked up the phone and called someone or actually spoken to someone face to face regarding the matter, I've already taken it to the Lord many times over, and he's given me clearance to be able to share that with that individual. And if not, then it remains in my prayer closet. And so I want to talk to you guys from the topic in this season. I want to talk to you on this Soulful Soul Care Sunday from the topic of self-examination. The two are kind of in the same category, though. Self-examination, and then subtopic, till your garden. And so we heard the saying many, many years ago, growing up in our youth, that sticks and stones may break your bones, but words will never hurt you. Now, what we have to know is that God formed heaven and the earth by way of words. And so if anyone knows that that's not true, God does. And guess who else does? The enemy. And so oftentimes, and I'm still, we're going to get to the point of offense. Oftentimes what the enemy will do is use words to break you down. And he doesn't start when you're older. He starts when you're young. And so some of the offenses that you may be experiencing now, they may not be new offenses. These may be things that you've been battling with for some time since your youth. And so when somebody is like a wound that's not treated, when someone steps on it or pokes it or gets close to it, it causes you to, ouch, that hurts. And the reason that it hurts, because it was never healed. And so the reason we're talking from the topic of self-examination is because it doesn't matter what someone says about you if it's untrue. But because you don't have to listen to that. You don't have to feed into that. You don't have to give yourself over to that. The thing that does matter is if they're saying something and it may got some truth to it. It may have a little bit of truth to it, you know? And so that's where we do our self-evaluation, our self-examination. And that's why, this is a healthy dialogue that's going to help. This is one thing I want you all to know. Those of you who have partnered with the ministry, the business, and are faithful to tune in to the JesusGirl.ent podcast, you won't ever have to worry about me breaking you down by way of words. Because I have experienced it enough for every single person I come in contact with in life. And that's why I don't let people do it around me. I don't like it. I am not one that's for it. Am I perfect? No, I'm not going to say that. However, I won't just intentionally try to destroy someone's character. character or intentionally try to just take jabs at someone just for the sake of just for the sake of joking, something funny, trying to make someone laugh. It's just not, there may have been a point in time where I thought that was cool, and I'm not gonna lie about it, as a young girl, as a teenager, maybe even young adult. However, when you grow up, and there are some things, some areas I still didn't cross over into with sharing and talking about people and things of that nature. I don't even allow people to bring that kind of stuff to me. And even if you don't care that it or think that it's funny, one thing people should know even by now with sharing with me things that's negative about other people is that I'm always, almost always, in favor of the underdog, unless the underdog has, you know, kind of gotten themselves into a place where they being dishonorable to God, then I'm praying for them, but I'm not, you know, really rooting for them like that. I want them to get it right with God first. But I'm always, almost always in favor of the person that's being kicked, that's being bullied, that's being talked about. I want to know why. I'm not one of those ones you can persuade, oh no, we're all against them and you should be against them too. No, I'm going to pray and then go see the situation out for myself, because I know that we live in a world, I said this on Friday, that loves lies. In addition to that, we also live in a world that loves to bully. And so you often see groups and groups of people tagging, just ganging up on one person or one body of people. And this has happened all throughout history. And I'm not one to just go with the flow of doing wrong to someone. I want to be on the right side of right every time it's presented. And so that's not something you got to worry about coming in here, that you're going to be judged negatively or have yourself brought down. If anything, you're going to be made better by way of some words that are going to help you so that you can improve in life. And so there's a such thing called constructive criticism. And then there's a criticism that tries to destroy. So it's like destructive criticism. So that is criticism where somebody doesn't care about you. They don't care about what you got going on. They just want to criticize you in a way to make you hurt, to make you cry, to make you feel humiliated and ashamed and bad, and just give up on life and give up on your dreams. That is destructive criticism. But constructive criticism provides a solution. Constructive criticism always provides a solution. And so if someone says, hey, you may need to work on this, or hey, I noticed this, can I help you with this? That is not someone that wants to destroy you or bring you down. That's someone that wants to help you. They see that you're struggling in this area, and instead of laughing at you, what most people do, instead of talking about you, what oftentimes happens as well, they're willing to extend to you what it is that you may need. And sometimes people get offended by that. But that's why you got to pray and ask God, because if you are being in the spirit, I'm telling you, God will tell you what to say, when to say, how to reach out, when to reach out. God will really show you these things. But when you skip steps, that's how people end up, you know, well, I tried and they ain't receive it. They'll receive God, anyone, because God created us all. So when he speaks, we listen. Even the seas and the winds obey him. So if you flow in the Holy Ghost, God will show you when to say it, how to present it, how to do it. He'll give you everything that you need. Okay. So in that, that's why we're talking about self-evaluation, self-examination, from the point of if there is some truth to what it is that they're saying about you. And so, you know what I mean? Like just a little bit. It's not completely true, but it's a little true. Or maybe maybe it is completely true, but you don't know the remedy for it. And so that's what we're going to talk about when we talk about self-evaluation, self-examination. One thing that I love about Hannah's character, 1 Samuel 1, Samuel's mother, Prophet Samuel's mother, okay, give her her respect, is that she did not try to fight Penina back about her accusations and the things that she was saying concerning her character as it pertained to her being barren. Hannah knew she was barren. And so that's what made Penina even a worse kind of character of a person, because it's one thing to talk about somebody about something they have the ability to do something about, but it's completely different to bully someone about something they have no control over. They have no control over. And then as a woman, Imagine how hurtful and harmful that was for her, that I'm not even naturally able to do what I was created to be able to do. So I'm experiencing pain on top of pain. Not only pain because you're talking about me, pain because it's true, and pain because I'm trying to do something about it, and I haven't been able to figure it out. I haven't been able to figure out the remedy. So we're going to take a lesson from her, because Hannah ended up getting what it is that she needed, and she also was able to silence the voice of the antagonistic one that was coming against her by way of the results that she received from God. And so first step to self-evaluation, self-examination, maybe something that they said is a speck of true, maybe it's a little true, maybe it's completely true, but you don't have no control over it. Seek the face of God. We see where there was opportunity for Hannah to talk to her husband. Her husband did not defend her. Her husband did not tell Penina leave her alone. Sometimes you may be in situations where you felt like somebody, maybe not even your spouse, maybe a parent, maybe a friend, maybe someone that's a close associate of yours was supposed to defend you or in position to defend you, and they did not. Do not get upset at them. We're getting rid of offense in this year. We're getting rid of offense in this season. Let them go, because they did what was than they means to be able to do, and maybe God didn't allow them to do because he wanted you to come to him. And so after Hannah saw that Elkanah wasn't gonna do nothing about her situation, she didn't even get into an argument with him. According to scripture, she went to the temple like they were going anyways. Okay, well, you see what's going on clearly. And instead of you trying to intervene on my behalf and fight, ward off the enemy and the words that have been sent against me. See, this is the thing. I'm going back to words real quick, and we're going to jump back to Hannah. The enemy knows that words have power. Just like God knows that words have power. He created the heaven and the earth. He created you by way of words. And then there were actions that followed that, but it began with a word. You were a word spoken by God. And so what the enemy knows is that if I want to combat the positive word that was spoken over God's daughter or God's son, then all I got to do is keep on saying this one negative word over and over and over and over again. And that's why sometimes you can feel as if I've gotten out of that place. I'm not even in that season. I'm not even at that area of maturity anymore. I've grown past that. But then that same insult or that same problem presents itself in a different arena. And that's because you did not deal with it, or the enemy sees there's still a level of weakness there that you have not overcome. And so he keeps sending it and sending it and sending it. And so when he sends that word, you got one or two options. Now we back with Hannah. Thank you, Holy Ghost. We're going to tie it all in. And so you got one or two options. You can either accept what the enemy has said over you, even though, see, this is the thing. When it's a lie and it's not God's will concerning your life, you won't even receive it. You won't even receive it in your spirit, no matter how many people say it, no matter how often you see that same thing concerning you, it will not be received within your spirit. Like, I just cannot receive that. That is not true. I don't know. I don't care if it looks like it's true. It's not. I don't care if it sounds like it's true. It's not. You just will not be able to receive it. So you got one or two choices when these negative words are being spoken concerning you and you're doing your self-examination, evaluation. You could A, accept it. Like, well, they just going to say that about me anyways. I'm just going to be that anyways. And just start referring to yourself as that identity and taking that on. Or you can B, reject it and take God at his word. And do things the way that God would have you to do it, so that you can put the enemy to shame and allow God's word to come true through you, so that people will be able to see a living witness. And so Hannah, she could have accepted what Penina said. You know what? She right. I'm barren. She just gonna talk about me anyways. They just gonna talk about me. That is my reality. Just accepted that. But within Hannah, she did not receive it. What happens with words is it only becomes true when you receive it. When you say within yourself, you know what? They got a point. I'm just going to be that. I'm just going to be what they call me. I'm just going to be whatever it is they want me to be. Okay, yep, whatever you want me to be. Then it begins to be true. And the enemy knows that. He can break you down by way of words. He may, you know, a physical attack, that'll hurt you for a season, for a little while. If it's an ailment in your body, it may hurt you sporadically here and there. But words can linger on indefinitely. And so that's why we're going to talk about what you can do to shift what it is that has been spoken concerning you. Now we're going to get to the point where we talk about tilling your garden. And so this is very, very important. And this is the reason we're talking about this. So we've gone through self-evaluation, self-examination, where you are examining yourself to see if anything that's being said about you has any form of truth to it, or if it's completely a lie. And you just, and this too, when you don't surround yourself with people that want to keep on repeating that lie, it is a good thing to depart from them or shut them out of your life, shut them out of this season, shut them out from around you. Words have power. So I am not, you're not going to see me hanging around people for extended period of time that are just loose with their words. Like, how do you not care what you say out of your mouth? How do you swear and how do you bless and curse out of the same mouth? And I'm not just saying curse where you saying negative words. I'm saying you cursing, like cussing, like saying cuss words out of the same mouth. I cannot be surrounded by people that use their words loosely. Now, I'm not saying that you may have had somebody was picking on you and you got to a point, then you may need to get some deliverance so it don't get to that point. However, if you're constantly just like that, those are the kind of people you want to try to avoid, because if they don't care what they say out of their own mouths concerning their own lives, concerning what's going on with them, they're not going to care what they say to you. And so maybe a few times for me correcting you, don't speak to me that way, don't say that to me, whatever the case may be, before it's a cutoff. And even Jesus knew the power of other people's words when you're getting ready to perform a miracle, so much so that when Jairus' daughter was getting ready to be healed by Jesus, he put everybody out. He told them she was asleep. They said she was dead. He said she's not dead, but she's sleeping. When she said that, they laughed him to scorn. Don't you know that when you believe God or someone else believes God on your behalf about something that God promised you, sometimes it can provoke laughter in the enemy? And even that laugh is an offense and an insult to God, because you're saying that when God said, is there anything too hard for God? You're saying yes. And the answer is an indefinite no. If he can raise Lazarus from the dead, if he rose Jesus from the dead, how much more can he do on behalf of you? And so he put them all out. When they were laughing at him, when he was getting ready to perform a miracle, he put them out. Why do you allow people to still be in your inner circle and still be around you that's laughing at you, that's mocking you, that's bringing you down, that's talking about you and saying all these negative words behind your back and in your face? And you just letting them just rip you to shreds. And you wonder why you feel so low. It's the silent attack of the enemy. And now it's not even all silent like that. Some of it is boisterous. And they just using their words little by little to tear you down. And you still thinking in your mind, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. And then you look up and you hurt. Real hurt. Soul wounds. Hurt in the area of your heart. Hurt in the area of your mind. Hurt. Trapped. Sometimes it can be ensnared by words that they said that you let get in your heart, and now you're repeating what you heard just like a parrot. Instead of declaring the word of God concerning yourself, now you're rehearsing the words of the enemy, and the enemy running rapid in your mind like a gerbil on a wheel. Those negative words that's been spoken, but we decree and declare freedom for you on today. And that whom the Son says free is free indeed. And he sent his word to set the captives free. That opposed to you listening to what the enemy has said, you're going to take God at his word. Because he is the living word. In every dead area in your life, you are going to apply the living word and recite it and live it and act on it and do whatever it takes for you to overcome in that area of weakness. Not your area of strength. I mean, you can polish your areas of strength, but your areas of weakness, those are the areas you really got to build up. The areas where the enemy was intentional about breaking you down in, I mean, kept hitting you and hitting you and hitting you there. And this is this too. You can't say you love me and you speak those kind of words concerning me. I'm sorry, but your words say that you love me, but your heart is far from me. And because it's far from me, I got to get far from you. Because I'm believing God for a miracle in my life. And so when it comes down to self-evaluation, self-examination, it may not be true. But because they keep speaking it over you or speaking it concerning you, now it's starting to appear to be true because their words is overshadowing you, like covering you, instead of God's word beaming through you. So people can't even really truly even get a comprehension of who you are because you're so covered by the words of the enemy. But I thank God that even God can create a butterfly that can burst out of a womb of a chrysalis. And baby Richard taught me that when he was about 5 or 6 years old. He loved art. He still does art sometimes, but he don't like everybody to be waiting for him to do art. But he used to do it so openly and beautifully. And I asked him to draw me the stages of a butterfly. And I wrote down like different vision points for each stage. And I said, I need a cocoon and I need a butterfly. And when that baby came back to me, he said, Mom, it's not a cocoon. I said, Richard, it is a cocoon. He said, it's not a cocoon. It's a chrysalis. And when he said that, I said, oh, let me go look this up. A chrysalis. And when I looked it up, it was true. A chrysalis covers one butterfly. However, a cocoon can cover many moths. And so all the time I'm saying cocoon and I'm up in there grouped up with moths, and God intended for me to be in a chrysalis all by myself where I can burst forth as a butterfly. And so may you take that as well for yourself on this Soulful Soul Care Sunday. And so now that we've done our self-evaluation, self-examination, and determined whether or not it got truth to it because of me and my actions, or maybe even truth to it because I allowed the enemy to keep speaking it concerning me and towards me and over me. Now I need to make the decision, earnest decision, to break forth out of it. And so this is how we're going to do that with tilling your garden. And so this is specifically for those who are always doing for others, but you don't take a lot of time to care for yourself. That's why I released the podcast episode entitled, Is Self-Care Selfish? And the answer is still no, a resounding no. And anyone that would tell you it is someone that don't want you to care for themselves because they want you to care for them. And that is selfish. And the reason I'm saying that is because, especially for mothers, fathers, leaders, any form of caregivers, sometimes you can get so big, grandparents, you can get so busy giving and giving and giving and pouring and pouring and pouring and doing and doing and doing, and no one's doing it for you. And then by the time you look at yourself, it's like, whoa, everything else around me is beautiful. Everything else around me is plentiful. Everything else around me is growing and glowing. And I didn't drain myself to the point of depletion. And God never intended that for you. You still his baby girl. I saw this very beautiful video when I was still on my, when I was still on one social media account that I have recently deactivated just for some time with God. And everyone was coming to see the new baby, but the father came to see his daughter who gave birth to the baby. And I thought that was so beautiful because even with bringing in new life, you got to realize that there's a child there that gave birth to a child. And so that woman is still a little girl in the eyesight of her father. And I'm saying that to those that are listening in, there's still a girl in you. There's still a boy in you, even though you may be grown and an adult. And so I'm giving you clearance and freedom this upcoming week to till your garden, to take care of yourself. Do some things that make you feel better. And I'm not saying splurging. Y'all go back and listen to the episode I released. It was one of the first episodes I released. It's either in 2020 or 2021. One of the first episodes had to be like episode 3, maybe 3 or 4. We on almost 200, episode 200 now, glory be to God. But maybe episode 2 or 3 is self-care selfish. Go listen to that. It's still a good word. I listened to it not too long ago. And it's not about finances. It's not about splurging. It's about truly, truly caring about the nature of your soul, which means that you may have to pull back and just get some peace and some serenity in the presence of God. God, love on me. God, examine me. Do some breathing exercises. Breathe in. Breathe out. Breathe in. Breathe out. And while you breathe in silence, it may not be able to be a lot of noise around you right now. You just need some peace and the comfort of the presence of God. God, love on me. God told me some time ago, let my love adorn you. Let the love of God adorn you again. because he did it before. And just like with Cinderella, you went around those who hated you, Joseph, and you allowed them to strip you of your garment. My God, today, thank you, Jesus. They stripped you. It's not that you didn't have it. It's not that you weren't glowing. He restored you. Just like with Ezekiel 16, when he talks about the illustration of a woman who God made beautiful, who was left to be barren and covered in her own blood. And God said, when I saw you polluted in your own blood, I said to you, live. Yea, I said unto you, live. And the time was a time of love, and I put my skirt over you. They weren't loving you, but I decided I was going to love you. I was going to take responsibility of you, that you were mine. You became mine, but you trusted in your own beauty. And to his is was, and to his is was. Don't you know when God began to glow you up and grow you up, sometimes you can become pompous and trust in your own works and think that you the reason that you are where you are and that you got what you got. And sometimes you begin to mishandle the things of God, and then God got to send forth judgment. He said, so I'm going to give you over to the will of your enemies because you were so willing to put yourself out there and make me look ashamed and forget about me. Now I'm going to let them, the things they done said about you, they're going to see it played out. That's some people's story. Some people is not. Some people is because you went around people glowing and growing, and they didn't like that. It's just like that movie when that dude was eating on that fruit and talking about some, I don't like that. I don't like that. Those of you who know different films, you will know exactly where that comes from. Some people can see you doing well, and because they don't like it, they got to say something. They got to say something. Even if it ain't true, they got to start something to bring down your glow. And especially if you left them high and dry. Now, come on here. We don't want to talk about that. People hate to see you doing better after a departure. They want to throw anything at you to make you fall. You a bird then flapped your wings and flying off and soaring off. And here they is, then got one of those. Y'all know that little good game we used to play on Nintendo? They done got a little something to try to shoot you at the sky. You ain't finna flow that high. Oh, Lord, help me, Jesus. Because they seen what God was doing in you. But may God restore you plentiful. Because you made the decision, I'm going to till my garden. Now, that comes from the Song of Solomon. I'm going to read it. Song of Solomon, chapter 1, verse 5. And it reads, I am black, but comely. O ye daughters of Jerusalem, as the tents of Kedar, as the curtains of Solomon. One verse down. Come on, come with me. Verse 6. Look not upon me because I am black. Because the sun have looked on upon me. My mother's children were angry with me. They made me the keeper of the vineyards. For those of you who always working on behalf of others. And they was angry with her and made her work. Come on here. Cinderella. You see all these different things that they try to do and make worldly, and they add all these different ungodly things to it. They done stole it from the Bible. Y'all better take y'all authority back and snatch it back. And give it its proper reference and make sure that God is being not plagiarized by the world. They done took it right up out the scripture and using it as, come on, Annie ain't nothing but an Esther. Come on here. It's scripture. They took it. They stole it. Stolen identity. And we got to put it back where it belongs. Glory be to God. Made me the keeper of the vineyards, but mine own vineyard have I not kept. And that is why this is for you. You pour into everyone. You give to everyone. And who's giving to you? And this is the thing about it. People are cruel. They'll take everything you got. That's why in this year, make a declaration over your finances. Put a stamp on your finances that I'm not going to run low on behalf of anyone else this year. Not this year. I may have done it last year before that, but this year I'm not going in poverty and broke on behalf of nobody. Because people will drain you of everything that you got and then laugh at you because you ain't got it. People will take all of your compliments that you pour into them. All of your time that you pour into them, all of your everything that you put into them, and then forget about you.
This is why Mordecai called Esther on her behavior. No, honey, I poured into you. I'm the reason that you got to be to the queen status. You're not going to get up there. Not me. He ain't take full responsibility. God is, but he used me to help you. But you're not going to get up there and forget about your people. And forget that maybe God called you to this for such a time as this. Y'all, I'm running out of time. I only got some seconds here. Do your self-evaluation this week. If something that is being criticized about have an inkling of truth to it, then go to God on behalf of that area and till your garden in that area. Don't be fruitful and bountiful all everywhere else. And in that area is reeking with weeds and it needs some attention. You need that attention. Take care of you because you only get one you and we need you. I love you and know that Jesus loves you more.
Silken dreams take flight as the darkness gives way to the dawn. You survived, now your moment has arrived. Now your dream has finally been born. Unkept, but your faith was as sure as the stars. Now you're free, and the world has come to see just how proud and beautiful you are. What the struggle brings.